Раз. Yeah. Okay, hi everybody. So let me start in this way. So what if I tell you you will lose your job in next 5-10 years? Like completely lost. Probably most of you are here programmers and you are thinking, what? I'm programmer and I will have job for long time. Okay, let me show you something. We are living in time when everything changed very, very quickly. Right now, we have fourth industrial revolution, and this is not only words, this is actually happened now. And let me show you some proof how it changed our life. Autonomous car, Tesla. Now, next example from Google. Waymo is brand, Google brand. And this is also autonomous car, but something more. Right now, you can order taxi. This taxi arrived, and you open door, and everything is the same, except you don't have driver, right? And this is a real example from Boston. Okay, probably you can say autonomous car, it's not big deal for now, everybody talk about this. What about autonomous bike?
The Dutch cycle more than any other nation in the world, almost 900 kilometers per person. But that also means we have 350,000 bike-related injuries. Now imagine that we would make biking safer, smarter, and easier by applying self-driving technology to biking.
We taught our self-driving bike to figure out where it is, what's around it, what will happen next, and what it should do. We leaned on Google's expertise in self-driving cars, but we had to adapt the technology to work on a bike. We decided to add two additional features. First, you can request the bike to pick you up wherever you are, and we developed a comfort mode, adjusting the pedals to a perfect resting position.
I think the self-riding bike could really give a boost to the economy because people could also work on their bicycle. You work in your office, you work in your home, you work in your car. You could even work on your bike.
Yeah, why not, right? Next example about vehicle as well, and right now we can go in under horizontal. What about vertical? Let's see. Few other example right now more about robot and agriculture. Apple, pick an Apple robot. Yeah, oops. Next example from construction, how to build a house in 2 days.
Mm-hmm.
right. You can say this is quite logical stuff and it's much, much easier than creative. Let's talk about creative things. Do you like classical music? All right. Please check, is it fake or real? This is not Bach, this is deep Bach. And this was generated by deep learning like a few years ago, inspired on Bach creativity. Next example, you have original image, you have some pattern combined together and you get something. All right, next example about fake news. We really live in interesting time when you should be very careful about what you see and what you hear. Let me show you why. Alright, next example about augmented reality. I think most of you know more or less what is it. You have kind of glass and you see something more than normally. But what do you think about hologram? Because actually you don't need glass to see something more than really exists. And this is a real example from a concert in Japan. Okay, you can say this is Japan, and this is okay, but the reality is this is actually traveling Hatsune Miku traveling around the world. For example, last time she visited United States. Maybe in this year we'll be visit next, actually 2018 we'll be visit Europe as well. So the life changed really quickly, and what it looks like a bit crazy for you now, probably in next year or in next few years will be normal. Let me show you a few business examples about machine learning and how this allows save money. First example from Google DeepMind, when they apply deep learning algorithms to save energy for cooling. And you can see on vertical line or y-axis, you can see machine learning algorithm was turned on and turned off. In this way, they save 40% energy. And just to say that this is Google, that means this is the space when people spend a lot of time to optimize. And it's not easy to save those amount of value, but it still works in terms of deep learning. Next example from PayPal, when for one problem what they have, fraud problem, they've reduced about 1% quality. So from 1.32 to 0.32. And for PayPal scale, they save about $1, $2, and $3 billion. And next example from medicine related with Stanford, actually two examples from Stanford. First one about heart and detect some anomalies. And it looks like that algorithm works at least the same like good doctor or even better. And another example, quite similar but a bit other, but also about medicine, that they can detect pneumonia the same level like radiologists. Okay, and you can say that machine learning or artificial intelligence is only for big players like Google, Facebook, Microsoft, and so on. And I work in small company, and probably I shouldn't care about this, or I cannot impact it, and I really don't need it. And let me show you some example from history. So here is on this image, this man call on the mobile phone, and this is, in theory at least, this is first call by mobile phone, and by the way, he is calling to his competitors to say that they actually finished and it works. Not there. And what I want to say now, when Motorola developed this phone and start advertise like, you will have mobile phone, you will get everywhere and so on, and people said, you know what, I'm not CEO, I'm not big boss, I don't need it. Why you tell me about this? And now, who doesn't have mobile phone today? Okay, who has two? Okay, it looks like work. The same will be about AI. That means that in next 5 years, 5 or 10 years, you will see that AI will be everywhere, even in small companies as well. Another interesting story about robots and replace job. There is a page when you can check your title and how big probability is that you will lose job in near future. And I've checked two. First one, account managers, and it looks like probability is really high. And second one, about analyst and architect. This is what actually I'm doing. It looks like much better. And long story in short, we have to dimension how big routing we are doing and how big variety is, and about what we are doing. Numbers, words, it's like Excel stuff, images, working with humans, and abstract thinking. So if we are in red rectangle, we are out even now. If we are in green, probably it's quite good, but life changes really, really quickly. And you can think in this way, I'm still a programmer, and probably I still non-replaceable, but I will show you next few examples. Generated code is not a new problem. People, like almost 50 years ago, start thinking about how we can generate a program. And first idea was prepare some rule and generate based on this rule. This is, of course, failed, because to generate from rule, you need formal specification. To prepare formal specification, usually it's much harder than prepare a program itself. So you can prepare just program without formal specification. But even if you have some rule which can adapt to non-formal specification, you still have kind of type and different stuff because human do it. And you should handle this. This is quite big problem. And the last one problem what you have is poor performance. So if you have only predefined rules, your program probably will be really bad one. But this is first approach. Let me show you again. Next example. Right now we have another approach, and not only this, there are a few other, like neural program synthesis. And it works, you have piece of code and you generate rest. I will show you how it looks like. On the left side, you have piece of code and red rectangle missing something. And on the right side, the green one, this is generated by program. And the program actually has two components in success metric. First one, it should work. And second one, it should have quite good performance. All right. And there are several startups. One of them is Near.ai, and those guys working on a project that generate a code in near future. So we'll see how it will go on. But I think a lot of things change in next 5 years. You can, after this presentation, you can say that it looks like robot can do very well different stuff, but let me show that still challenges exist and they need help. Oops, oops, oops. Ooh. Yeah. Game over. All right, so they need help. And another thing, this is from Europe. In 2020, expected that market needs about 10, even and half millions people who will work with data, and this is almost doubled number 4 years ago. Even 4 years ago, in demand was much bigger than market already has, and in next few years will be much bigger again. So the question is how to manage this, because university usually don't care a lot about this. All right, right now probably it's a bit changed. I know a few small programs in the most, the biggest ones, university in Poland, for example, but this is still like 100 people, not about 1,000 and not about millions. And this is why probably you should care about yourself. You should start learn, and maybe this is a good time to retrain yourself to programmer 2.0. Right. There is a good article about software 2.0, and this is not like software 2.0 will be totally replace classical software. This is more about extended, that some more complicated things probably you will develop by yourself, but most simple stuff you will give for robot and don't care about this. And let's say you decided, okay, I want to retrain myself, and what I should do? You, for example, you can go to Google Scholar, you will type machine learning, you will find a lot of results. Assume that you will spend 10 minutes per one, you will don't sleep, eat, and so on, and you need 70 years, more or less. Yeah, it's quite optimistic. But this is not the biggest problem. Next one problem is when you open, for example, first one, it will look like this. And normal programmer probably will feeling more or less like that. This is what I'm feeling. And what I'm trying to say now that there are two different roles, like driver and mechanic. Mechanic knows everything about engine. Driver knows about how to drive, right? And those both roles has pros and cons, but this is different roles. And for example, drivers has other problem, for example, like how to avoid traffic jump, or how to park and don't pay, for example, and so on. And drivers should go from A to B. Drivers don't know about engine. And there are like few billions drivers in the world, and only few of them, maybe a few percent of them, really knows how engine works. And I assume that mechanic knows. This is sometimes optimistic assumption as well. You know what I mean. Right. And mechanics, we can say, like, research is kind of mechanics, and we don't need a lot of researchers, right? And Google DeepMind and other lab actually do it, those stuff. We will need much more drivers in near future. Okay, let's check how looks like machine learning workflow, and just to explain and clarify a bit in practice. So here is the whole workflow about at least classical machine learning. First step is about understand data and understand business. Oh, by the way, who love driving on bike? Like, you don't use car? Yeah, a few people. Okay. Do you have? I'm not sure about. Probably yes. Can you rent a bike in Wrocław? Right. Okay. And you have the station. You come to the station and nothing. Right. This sometimes happened. And this is not good because you have some plan and you don't have bikes, right? And this is a problem which we try to solve. We have historical information about each station per hour, how many bike was needed, and we want to assure that we have needed amount bikes for a given station for a given hour. And this is what we are doing. Right now we talk about business. Let's check about data. This is quite simple stuff, but I will show you the idea. So, for example, you have two charts. On the top is 1 year, 2011. On the bottom, 2012. On the X, you have hours from 0 to 24. On the Y, you have numbers, how many bikes you will need for a given hour. And for example, you can and green, this is working hours, and blue, weekend, working days and weekend. Now, you can see that in working days, people need bikes from 6 to, let's say, 9, and come back from 17 or even 16 to 20, let's say, more or less. And weekend people usually don't work, probably it makes sense. but they need a bit longer bikes, for example, in late hours, for example, 1 o'clock or 2 o'clock, and so on. Here is another example about the same, but another approach, how to show. For example, in 9 hours, you can see how big variation is between how many bikes you really need, from, let's say, 50 to 850. And from this amount numbers, you should find right one. For example, for night, it's really simple. At 4 a.m., usually nobody needs bikes. This is much easier to predict. And what the outcome should be from this? When you look at data, you will have some question. And from real business case, you will find really interesting scenarios that you have something, it doesn't make sense, like logically thinking, but it happened. And when you ask business will say, okay, we have some exception. If this, we are doing that. If that, we are doing this, and so on. And this is kind of cycle. You will look at data, you will learn what is inside, and come back to business to clarify, is it okay, or something wrong is going on. Now, about understanding data and business, this is quite obvious task, and this is very often, at least in my experience, what I saw, that people skip this step, like just start doing machine learning before understanding what they are doing and what's the problem they try to solve. The idea is that sometimes you don't need machine learning itself. This is not about marketing. You should understand how big effort you should spend for a given problem, and probably it will be easy to keep one person who will click somewhere and instead of automated by machine learning. But right now, more and more and more tasks we can solve by machine learning, but you should do it by, you should make this decision. It's not like automatic decision. Okay, let's go next. Feature engineering. First, let me explain what does mean features. You have a table with data, rows and calls. Row, this is object like bike, bike one, bike two, bike three, and columns or features, this is attributes of for given object. For example, temperature or daytime, season, hour, day, month, and so on. In other words, this is the way to explain machine what's going on. So machine has access only here. He doesn't check some camera or whatever. He has access here, and in this way, it can verify actually what's going on. Now, when you have some columns, you can extract one column, few more columns. In this way, you can get much more value. Let me show you an example. For example, if you have dates, like one column, you can extract day, month, year, hour, is it weekend, is it holiday, how so far to holiday, day before, day after, number of day in month, in year, in week, and so on. For example, in Monday, it will be different pattern than in Tuesday, and so on. But before you don't have information about Tuesday, right now you will have it just to extract by this. And a few other examples about categorical variables when you can extract more. I will don't explain details, but the idea is you have something, and based on this information, you extract something more. Another example, maybe quite trivial, but good enough to understand better. Let's say you have apartment, and you have height and width, and now you don't have area. But if you times those two numbers, you will have third column, and this third column will be area of your apartment, and this is a really good one. And here is a real example about transforming the code. So the first group about date, later you check some popular time, next one about holiday, and so on. Okay, let's say you generate a lot of features. Next step is feature selection or reduce number of features, because if you have too much, you will have so noisy result. It's like if you should make a decision and you have choice, like first one, you have only two options which you want to decide, and second one, you have 1,000 options, which one is easy for you? I think it's obvious. When you have only two options, or yeah, let's say two options, it's much easier to understand better what actually want to achieve. If you have 1,000 options, it's much easier to lost because it's too much. the same machine learning feel about number of features. If you have so much, that means this algorithm probably will be less stable and will be overfitting. And this is why we want to reduce. How we can reduce features? There are different strategies about this. So for example, you can check, first of them is variance. So you check column, let's say number one, and you see the all value is 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, and in the last one is one. So you can say that I have a column which contains the same elements. Probably I don't need this column. Next example, you check right now pair, like first and second one, and you see how big correlation between them. If correlation is really big, like close to one, that means that you won't keep only one of them, and second one you can remove. And last one, actually the best one, but is really hard, and this is why we need previous one, this is recursive model. So what you are doing, you build your model once, later you remove something, first one, last one, random one, and build model again. And just check, is it better or no? If better, you assume that, okay, I don't need this feature. And in this way, you can check all combination, but if you will check all combination without removing features using those variants and invariant or other stuff, you will have so much combination. This is why you cannot start from recursion, you should start from something more simple. All right, let's say you reduce features and you have valid ones. Next one about model selection. So there are different models, start from linear one. Who knows linear model? Like logistic regression and, okay. Who knows about decision tree? Okay, random forest, a bit less. Gradient boosting or boosting itself, one person. And neural network, neural network probably should be much more popular. All right, so yeah, this is about complexity, more or less. Just to recall for people who don't know about linear model. So let's say you have red point, this is true value. This is the value what we want to predict. Green point, this is what model said. Now, let's pick first one model, and we have some distance between green and red, and we calculate this distance. The same we do for second one, for third one, and so on, and so on. And finally, we summarize the whole distance, and this is our error. Now, the goal of model is minimize this distance in the way to reduce this error. And we will try to do everything to connect it green points with red one. Decision tree, it's quite simple to understand. You have question, for example, you pick feature age, and you ask about age, is under 15 or no, if yes, left, right, no, and so on. You have another question, is it male, no, yes, and so on. And in this way, you split your data in some subset, and next, when you have a new data, you just going through this tree, and you arrived in some node, and what you are checking, what is the most popular for given node, and this is your answer. Next example about gradient boosting at ArcGBoost. ArcGBoost, who knows about ArcGBoost? Okay, one, two, okay. Yeah, here is, when in doubt, use ArcGBoost. This is probably what you want to remember about machine learning. If you want to start doing this, please remember the name of this framework and check how it works. And there is a big probability that you really want to use it in practice. All right. Let's say we have different models, extra tree, random forest. We have normal list. Later we have normal four, iterated one by one, and just check on which one is the best one. And the last step, actually before last step, tuning hyperparameters. So we have a model. This model needs some external parameters or hyperparameters. And how to find it? You have different approach. Grid search is the most popular, but the worst one. Don't use it, just know that this exists and don't use it because this is not good. Random search, try to solve this problem. I will explain what's the problem with grid search. The problem is that, let's say you have only two parameters. Usually you have even more than two. And what you are doing, you check everything, every combination. For example, let's say you have random forest and you should specify two parameters. Max dev, how big dev should be for given tree, and number of trees. right? For example, number of trees can be changed from, let's say, 10 to 100 with step 10, and max depth can be changed from 1, from, let's say, 5 to 10. Now you have 5 here, 10 here, 5 times 10, you have 50 examples. But this is really trivial example. Usually you have much, much more combination. Sometimes you have few thousand combination in this way because you have, let's say, 10 parameters which you want to fit. And if you just calculate it very quick, you will turn out that you need like 100 years to verify everything. And this is why usually it doesn't work in practice. It works very good in book, in theory, but doesn't work in practice because it's so, so slow. Random search tried to solve this problem in the way that it's tried to do randomly. Like, we define how many points we can check, and it's randomly tried to check. Sometimes it works, sometimes it doesn't work. There are some papers which try to explain that you can use it in practice, but to be honest, it's a bit non-deterministic, so you should be careful about this. And the last one what I recommend, this is Bayesian. Bayesian optimization, which actually solving the problem in the way that, so in grid search, for example, if you know that some area doesn't make sense because you see that error growing and growing up, you don't want checking more in this area because it looks like bad area. For example, something more than 10 trees in random forest, for example, doesn't make sense. Let's say, assume something. And grid search doesn't care about it. Just checking like a robot. I'm checking everything what you said to me. Bayesian actually tried to reuse previous knowledge to optimize next step. And in this way, you have much, much smarter steps. And here is real implementation for Bayesian optimization. The name of library is HyperOpt. It's very simple to use. You have three group or three things what you should define. First one, you should define your objective function. Inside objective function, you can treat like, okay, from HyperOpt, objective function is kind of black box. You do something magic stuff, for example, build your model, validate your model, and get score. And last line in objective, you have return loss. And in this way, you inform HyperOpt how good this solution was. Second group here is space. You should define space where you're looking for your parameters. And last one, actually, you're running everything together and define how many atoms you need. For example, for a given case, you checked 15 times. And usually 15 times or 20 or 30, it's good enough to solve almost most problems what you will have. Compare like few like 20 or 30 compared to a few thousand grid search, it's big difference. But the quality will be almost the same or even better with HyperOpt. So just to sum up, HyperOpt can do something like 10 times or 100 times or even a few thousand times quicker than grid search. All right, let's say you have few models, two models or three models. Next step, what you can do, you can get each one. Next, you predict for model B and for model E some result, and later you get 60% from model B and 40% from model E and sum up together. And real example, for a given case, I have three models, and what I'm doing, I predict for all of them some value, and now I pick random forest 20%. Next, I have 80% for rest, and inside this unit, I have 30 and 70%. For ArcGBoost, I have the most because this is ArcGBoost, but sometimes you need other models which can improve. So how you can understand this, what I'm showing you now, that it's like in life, you have a team and you're looking for people not the same strength, let me say. So if you have a team and everybody can do the same, it's similar like you have only one person. What you want to do, you want to find few people or 5 people, 10 people, what is good in general, but all of them has something different. For example, one is better in assembler, second one in Java, last one in Python, whatever. And if you combine together those people, it will be amazing team. The same idea is here. All of this model try to solve problem in our own way. And if you combine those model, probably you will get better result. Okay, something on DESER, about deep learning. Who knows about deep learning? Okay, quite popular topic. So here is a chart why we should care about deep learning. We can simplify a bit, because this is a bit simplification, really. So we have two dimensions. One dimension is about capability, how good model is to simulate given problem. That means how good is to understand all nonlinear correlation. And second one about interpretability. And if we talk about linear model, usually we have capability quite small, quite low, but interpretability quite good, because everything is transparent and you can very easy verify what actually change in or how impact on result. Decision tree, it's kind of in the middle. Usually people say that decision tree can be interpretable. This is kind of true in theory again. For example, if you have a book and you have in page simple tree which contains only three levels, you can interpret, this is true. But in real life, you very often has, let's say, 1 million nodes. In theory, you can interpret this because it's simple, like binary split and so on, but 1 million nodes, it's too much to understand at least by one normal human. And this is why it's a bit tricky. And last one about boosting and deep learning, this is the most capable, but on the other hand, it's really hard to interpret. And about machine learning, kind of joke, why about linear model, why it's kind of not good enough very often. And here is, we have just married woman, and there is a person, data scientist, ninja, and he asked, look, yesterday you had zero husband, today you has one, in the end of month you will have about 30 or kind of. So it doesn't make sense probably, right? Real life, it's much more complicated than linear equation. But this is what actually happened with linear models, that they are tried to oversimplify our life. Okay, another example about deep learning. If this is works, for example, for PayPal, they save money about $2 billion. Business will say, okay, I probably won't go in this direction. I don't know how it works, but I won't go. But on the other hand, I won't reduce a risk in some way. And this is why a lot of researchers right now from the biggest labs like DeepMind and other think about how we can interpret the model like neural networks. And what they figure out, there are different ideas, but one of them is we have some neural networks. In this network, we'll try to explain why she decide this or that. For example, you have this image. What do you think on this image is? From your point of view, what we have. How you classify this image? If I ask you what you see, what you said? Probably dog, right? Labrador. Model said Labrador, acoustic guitar, and electric guitar. And you ask, okay, why? And he try explain. Electric guitar because this part, acoustic guitar because that part, and Labrador because this. And this is more or less makes sense. Like you can check, okay, this models, try to find some given parts and explain why it works. This image a bit tricky, but this model still explain why it works. But another example, when Husky classify as wolf and you ask why? Because snow. And this doesn't make sense. And in this way, you can understand, okay, probably I have some bad data when I train my model and it's correlated with snow, but this doesn't make sense for general, for common sense. And in this way, we can try to manage this risk. Okay. Quick recall how neural network works. Who buy a house or apartment in near future? Okay, people, you will help me. So I'm simplify this problem. Probably you will have much more variables than I have here. I have only one variable or feature, this is area. And second one, this is about price. So on X area, on Y is price. And how it looks like from neural network point of view, it will be, so we have area 100 times cost per meter and times plus some bias. Bias means like something what we can understood and we should sum up those things. Let me explain in other way. For example, if you have a really, really small apartment, let's say a few meters, you still pay at least 80,000 or something like this because you don't have a few thousand zlotys any apartments, even if this apartment is really small, right? And this is kind of underfitting what our model don't know. Now, let's complicate a bit this example. We will have two features. First one, again, area, and second one is number of rooms. So area is the same, number of rooms, and right now we reduce our bias. That means that we had understood a bit better our problem, and this is why bias is reduced. And the goal of machine learning or neural network for a given case is to find those weights. So when we start, we don't know this weight. We know area, we know number of rooms, we know this bias. Actually, bias don't know as well. So we know those two, and we should find weights. How we are doing this? We start randomly, like something. We avoid zero. We don't want to start with zero, with some mathematical things, but let's say we start with few, like 5, 10, 2, something like this. And we are checking, this is a bit different that we want to achieve. And what we are doing, we try to find better weights to minimize the final output. Okay, I think it's more or less clear on intuition level. The goal of neural network is to find weights. And last thing, as you see, everything is numbers. Feature is number, weight is number, output is number. Some example about recognize digit. So here is some two-layer hidden levels network and output. Each pixel has some value. Now, so here is the Python what actually solved this problem. You read data. You prepare data, for example, normalize each pixel because it should be from zero to one. Normally, pixel has value 255. You divide it by this, and so on. And the red rectangle show when we define neural network. How you can see this really simple. You actually said, I need two layers, two hidden layers, those sphere dense. And actually, for this, we have an even lie. One hidden layer and one output layer. Next one is compile and fit. That's all. So it's not really hard to define this neural network. I think if you have some subject on university a few years ago and try to implement by yourself neural network, it was much more complicated, I guess. And the result what you give, it will be error one a bit more percent. And the best result what you can achieve is zero. So the difference is not so much. You just type a few lines and you have a really good example. Next thing about convolutional neural networks. So you have more advanced example, autonomous car, and you want, once the problem what you have is recognize traffic signs. And this is again quite simple. You have neural networks, a bit more complicated, but still it's really a simple one, few more layers, and that works. But you should be careful that sometimes you have, life is unpredictable, what I can say. All right. Now about problems what machine learning has. The problem is that usually we train model from scratch in every company what we have. That means even if we have the same problem, we are isolated from each other and try to solve problem independently. And this is why some initiative come like reuse knowledge. There are a lot of them, transfer learning, lifelong learning, and so on and so on. This is not the same, but most, actually, all of them contain the part reuse knowledge. That means that we build model once, and we want to reuse this knowledge in other example. And quick explanation what I mean by this. There is ImageNet competition, and in 2010 it was started. 2015 they exceed human level, and right now it's a bit better. And as you see, in given year, almost all teams has result less than 5% error. That means that this level is repeatable. Actually, I don't know why not all has this, because it's really repeatable, but there are some individuals that don't want reuse knowledge for some reason, don't care about this, but most of them can reuse this knowledge. And even you, after this presentation, can download few the best models and classify this image. So presentation without cat, usually bad presentation. I have cat. Now, we have this cat, put this cat to our model. This is the whole code. This is really the whole code, just a few lines. You download this ResNet weight ImageNet. It's one line, but do something more, like download quite big model, 100 megabytes more or less. And after this, you predict what is on this image. And you have Tabby, Lynx, Egyptian cat. If you check in Google, you will see that this is a good answer. All right, and next example related with medicine. Let's say you have eye, and you want to define, you want to say, is it sick man or no? And you don't use all features what you have before. You just reuse, let's say, half or a bit more weights. There is some trick how to do it. You just kind of split given model before and learn on the top on this. But the result looks like you have much better result. This one thing, much better result. Second thing, you need much less data. And last thing, you have result much quicker because you don't need train model from scratch. And in the end, I will show you quite quick example. Let's say you have two persons and you should say, is it the same or no? Is it the same person? Okay, yes. So how this model will work? We will have the person. First model will detect 6 to 8 points on the face. And second one will be checked, is it the same or no? And by combining those features, those information into vectors, later we compare. And now if the distance is less than 0.6, the answer is the same. You can ask why 0.6? Because this is magic. This is machine learning, and it looks like works if you have this value. It's kind of threshold. In machine learning, you have a lot of magic, like coefficient. And actually, in books, usually people don't inform about this. If you have normal classical books, you will read, you have algorithms, it works, everything is good. But when you try hands-on, you will have those constant. And this is OK. Don't care about this. You have some constant. And now, yeah, this is the same person. What about this man? Yes, no? Yes. Yeah, yes. This? No? Yes? Unfortunately, yeah. What about this? Unfortunately, yes, but model said no. But it was very close. It was like 61, I guess, more or less. All right, how it looks like if you want to repeat the same? You read two models. One of them detect 68 points, second one convert to vector. Here is example of what does mean 68 points. And in this way, even if you move your face in this way or in that way, it will be detect your face really, really good. All right, and second part, you calculate this vector. And last one, you calculate the difference between vectors. It's really simple code, works. You don't need to spend a lot of effort for this. So in summary, machine learning works quite good even for now. Deep learning usually means a lot of data. And last one, I think you should remember that to reuse knowledge is very important in near future. And few announcements in the end. If you want to learn a bit more about machine learning, there is a course. This is in Polish, unfortunately, for non-Polish speakers. So dataworkshop.eu, you will have information about programmers 2.0. Even you will have promo code, just use code Europe. And last one, if you want to give all links what I show in here, you can join or subscribe here. Dataworkshop.eu, code Europe, and you will receive free emails, one per week, and you will analyze by yourself all the code what you have. So this is totally free. And last thing about announcement, I have podcast about artificial intelligence in business. The name is Business Myśli. This is most in Polish. Actually, one episode was in English, but most in Polish. So if you are interested in about artificial intelligence, I invite you here. And here is contact to me. If you have any question, feel free to reach out to me. I will try to help you. That's all. Thank you very much.